Pray with me, please. Father God, I just thank you. Lord, I thank you because we can have a hope that's bigger than us. Lord, it's bigger than circumstances. It's bigger than what we can do. It's a hope that you have forgiven sins. It's a hope that when we turn to you, the one thing that we can't do, we can't earn righteousness. But your word says we're forgiven. And so, Lord, we thank you for the hope of eternal life. So, Lord Jesus, would you cultivate that hope in our hearts through your word today? Would you use it in a powerful way to not only help us to know who we are in your eyes, but Lord, but to get to know you better and better and better and better so that we can grow in a relationship with you and we're not prone to religious practices that distance us from you or somehow make it okay to not have a relationship with you. But we are driven by the hope that our personal relationship with you gives us. We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's kind of quiet, subdued today. It's okay. It's a small crowd. You guys can get fired up today. Our text today, we are continuing in Luke chapter 5. And I'm excited about our text today. Luke 5 is just all of Scripture is so powerful. But Luke 5, again, I started this. Remember where we began 2 weeks ago with Peter and the catch of the fish in Luke chapter 5? And then last week you heard Marcy talk about the healing of the leper. And this week we're talking about Jesus healing the paralyzed man. Now, we can come before all these events and we can look at them for what they were. These were events, these were real events where Jesus did something during his ministry here on earth. But the other thing about Luke chapter 5 is we get to insert ourselves into these texts. Because it's not just about something Jesus did 2,000 years ago. It has significance today. And that's what we've been talking about over the last 3 weeks. Let me remind you, if I could, and it's so important that we remember this because all of this is flowing from when we went back 4 weeks ago when we talked about how Jesus, he went to the synagogue in Nazareth, his hometown, and there he read from the book of Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2. And let me remind you, because Luke chapter 5 is Jesus proving what he said. And it's so important that we understand this. God never says anything for nothing. Does that make sense? There are no idle words or idle promises from God. There are from us. Okay? We make idle promises. We say idle words. And we say things that we'd like to do and then never do. God does not do that. When God says something, he's going to do it. And when Jesus goes to the synagogue and he reads from Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2, and he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he's anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, the blind will see, and the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come. The year, the era of grace has begun." And Jesus says the scriptures you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day. That's important we understand, because what does Jesus do then? He starts to do it. He doesn't just say it, he does it. First thing we saw was he cast out a demon. Then we saw where he sat down with Peter, the miraculous catch of fish that brought us to last week where we saw the leper being cleansed. And this week we move to another miracle. Jesus heals a paralyzed man. Before we get into the text today, I'd like to show you a real quick video. I want to just preempt this video by saying a couple things. I don't know if some of you that are my age or older are going to remember a miniseries that came out in the 70s called Jesus of Nazareth. I remember that profoundly affected me as a child. It wasn't enough to make me believe, but I thought it was pretty amazing. So I go back every so often, and I still have this miniseries on DVD. But you know, it's kind of old. It's 70s. But it's still pretty powerful. I want to show you a video that was from that mini-series. You're going to see that the vocal track is just a little off, but it's very powerful, and it gives us a good image of what it looks like. So watch this video. Across Luke chapter 5, what we see is that in the first part where we went to in Luke chapter 5, we see that Jesus has the power to call. He has the power to call people to himself. The second thing we see next as we continue into Luke chapter 5 is that Jesus has the power to cleanse, make us clean. Our sins, all the things that we do that somehow make us unclean, we see that Jesus has the power to clean. And then today we're looking at Jesus has the power to forgive. It's so important. As we begin to build a personal reason, not just the fact that we are born again or we have faith in Jesus Christ, but as we form a defense of our faith, and as the world comes at us and says, why Jesus? Why is he the only way? Well, this case is being made through the Gospels. Who else has the power to call, the power to cleanse, and the power to forgive? It's important because, see, there's not another religious leader that's ever been born that has started a movement that has those three powers. And it's important because it all points to the fact that Jesus is God. Only God can do what Jesus has done. So we come before our text today as we begin to unpack it for you, starting with verse 17. It says that one day while Jesus was teaching, some Pharisees and teachers of religious law were sitting nearby. It seemed that these men showed up and from every village in all Galilee and Judea, as well as from Jerusalem. Now, fascinating point, at this point in the gospel, we're introduced to the religious leaders of Israel. And I want to just take a minute to set these folks up. What is Luke talking about? He's talking about the Pharisees and the religious teachers. Now, in other translations, it says scribes. Who were these people? Well, first of all, let's take scribes. Scribes were highly educated theologians of the day. They were the one, if we were to make a modern equivalent of the scribes, they were seminary-trained professors of theology. Okay, so they had this great academic biblical knowledge of Scripture. Now, that's important to understand because a lot of us strive to be that type of person. Maybe many of us are drawn to theology and we want to know a lot about Scripture, which is good. We should all be drawn to that to some degree. But those are the scribes. Now, the Pharisees are like religious teachers. If we were to take a modern day equivalency, they're like the ministers of word and sacrament. Okay, I am not a professor of theology. That's actually a formal position within many denominations, that type of person. But a pastor or a religious leader is more like the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees, which literally means separated ones, the Pharisees and the scribes of the day were dedicated to Scripture. Okay, it's important we understand that. It's important that originally, as they started out, we want to obey the Bible. This goes all the way back. Pharisees started to emerge from a time during the Great Exile, the Babylonian Exile. And what had happened is all these displaced Jews had begun to stray from the authority of Scripture. And here comes this sect of believers, of godly people that said, you know what, we're going to get back to the authority of Scripture. And they became the Pharisees of the time. Now, it's important. You may say, hey, these Pharisees sound like pretty good people. But here's the deal. The Pharisees in Jesus' time are the enemies of God. Now, how did they get there? How did Pharisees and scribes, these people that were so into the Bible, how did they become people who were literally opposing Jesus during his ministry? You're going to start to see, as we go deeper into Luke, you're going to see the Pharisees emerge as the enemies of Jesus. How can that be? Well, as we begin to understand Pharisees, we have to start with an acknowledgement that there's a little bit of Pharisee in every single one of us. Now, some of us, there's a lot of Pharisee, okay? But we all have it to some degree. And I'm going to, when we talk about the separated ones, these were people that because of their knowledge of the Old Testament, and essentially if you take the law of Moses, the first five books of the Bible, and they were so focused on the penalty for sin, that the reason why they're called the separated ones is because they knew that sin corrupts us. They knew that sin somehow made us unclean. So what they did, in order to somehow achieve a level of righteousness, they thought it was important to separate themselves from sinners. Now, if you're starting to read this and you understand the irony and how the Pharisees became enemies of God, it's because they thought there was a separation between them and sinners. You see, they thought that because the law was so important to them, somehow, some way, they became righteous. And so the key to righteousness in the eyes of a Pharisee is to do works. It's to somehow live a perfect life in such a way that God says, okay, all right, you know what? You're in because you lived such a perfect life. Now, when you study the zeal of the Pharisees, here's kind of an interesting subject of the Pharisees. The Pharisees, actually, one of their main texts is called the Mishnah or the Talmud. Now, just to kind of let you know, so they have the Old Testament. They believed in the Old Testament, but the Old Testament itself wasn't enough. The law wasn't enough. They began to expound on the law and actually telling people how they can obey the law and thereby achieve righteousness. And that's where the Mishnah comes from. Now, here's something interesting about the Mishnah. The Mishnah is made up of 63 tractates or chapters. 63 chapters. So this is outside of the Bible. And in its standard print today, the Mishnah is over 6,000 pages of exposition on the law and scripture. 6,000 pages. So, think about that. So here we go. This is their zeal, and this is their way. They're so driven by works-based righteousness. They are so driven by religion that they actually came up with another 6,000 rules, essentially 6,000 pages of rules, apart from the law itself that's in the Bible. So this is how these things happen. And as we look at ourselves and we examine our hearts, we do the same thing. Maybe not to this extent, but we start to create rules about God that are not in the Bible. And it's all because we have this natural desire to somehow separate ourselves from other sinners. We want to say, well, I'm a sinner, yes, okay. The Bible says I'm a sinner, so therefore I'll admit that I'm a sinner, but I'm not a sinner like that person. Okay, so that if you're moving into that, or if you struggle with ideas like that, you're moving into the mindset of a Pharisee. And it's not a good place to go. Now today, what's really kind of fascinating to me is that we have modern day equivalencies of Pharisees, which are I call them the Jesus plus something people. Okay, so they're believers in God, they believe in Jesus, but the only way to be saved is Jesus plus something. So if you're going to be saved and if you want to have a relationship with God, you've got to be a Jesus plus something person. There's something that you have to do outside of grace and the forgiveness that Jesus Christ offers if you want to be saved. And that's the reason why you have people that go through their whole lives knowing about Jesus, confessing him as their Lord and Savior. They get to their deathbeds and they're terrified. They're terrified because they didn't live a good enough life. And I have seen that. I've had that, and I know so many people close to me. I've been with family members close to me on their deathbed in tears saying, I didn't live a good enough life. And I said, none of us do. Understand grace and forgiveness. But you see, religion produces fear of grace. Jesus really forgive? Am I really forgiven? Am I really clean? And see, we hear these words, but you see, when we get into religion and we add all these rules that we can't achieve, then all of a sudden the guilt settles in again. We're like, you know what? I'm just not getting it done. I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough to be a follower of Jesus because I'm not like that person over there. But see, here we have these Pharisees. So here's the background. These Pharisees have heard about the cleansing of the leper. They've heard about the casting out of the demons in the synagogue. And so they hear that these things are happening with Jesus, and they're coming to see for themselves. But you're going to watch this, and it's very important. There's really important language in this text to see why Jesus has an issue with them. So let's keep going. They showed up from every village in Galilee and Judea as well as from Jerusalem. And the Lord's healing power was strongly with Jesus. So Jesus had this anointing. He had this spiritual presence and this power for healing that day. Now we get to verse 18. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a sleeping mat. They tried to take him inside to Jesus, but they couldn't reach him because of the crowd. I want to stop right there. One of the things that a lot of Pharisees and religious people do is they like to take the best seat in the house. They like to take the best parking spot. They like to take the best seat. They like to take all of these things. And what's so often so fascinating is they actually become an hindrance to people coming to Jesus. I tell our leaders in the church constantly, I tell people, especially on special events, take a parking spot far away. Take a seat. Come in late so that other people can have your seat. You know, some churches, and I'm not talking about anything specific. I'm talking in broad terms. But have you ever been to a church where it's like everybody has assigned seats and you accidentally sit in one and you get that look? This is my seat. All right. Sorry. I guess I won't come back again. You can have your seat next week and for the next 1,000 weeks after that. But see, religious people, they want their seat, right? They want these things. And as we come to Christ, we have to understand that there's an element of us as followers of Jesus where we've gotten it, okay? We've been given the gift. Now we as a people have to know that it's about bringing other people into the presence of Jesus. It drives me crazy when churches forget this. Okay, we know Jesus. If you're saved and if you've got a relationship with Jesus, congratulations, you're in. Now make room for others to come in. That's our role as a church. It's not our role to keep people out because we want the best seat and we want to be separated from sinners. You're going to see this. You're going to see the nature of Jesus. And if we're going to be like Jesus, we have to have the same mindset. You also see in this case, you see friends, people taking this paralyzed man to Jesus. Sometimes as followers of Christ, we have to go the extra mile to take other people to Jesus. Just to throw this out there, nobody needs to answer this, just answer it internally. When's the last time you went out of your way to bring somebody to Jesus? When's the last time you allowed yourself to be inconvenienced or to somehow sacrifice to bring people to Jesus? Well, that's what these guys did. They probably could have gotten there earlier, maybe to get an upfront seat with Jesus, but they didn't do that. They came carrying their friend because he was paralyzed. And they wanted to bring him before Jesus. And this is this image of how we should be living as people of faith. They couldn't reach him because of the crowd. So they went up to the roof and they took off some tiles. Back then, oftentimes the roof was like a porch type place. And they usually had stairs leading up to the roof. So they were able to get up on the roof and remove the tiles, as you saw, as they dropped him down in front of Jesus. They couldn't get in there. They took off some tiles. They lowered the sick man on his mat down into the crowd right in front of Jesus. Now here's what's it gets very fascinating. Jesus, it says, seeing their faith. So it wasn't the fact that they brought this man before Jesus. And one of the things, whenever we see miraculous healings in the Bible, there's a tendency to say that Jesus, all we got to do is bring people to Jesus and he'll automatically heal them. Okay? That sometimes does happen. Okay, I believe in miraculous healing. I believe in all those things. I believe they still happen today. And the reason why I believe that is because I've seen it. But it's not a mandate on all healing. It's important we understand that. There was an element of faith in this situation. This situation was unique. Jesus said to the man, "Young man, your sins are forgiven. You have been forgiven." But look how the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law react. They said to themselves, "Who does he think he is? That's blasphemy, a misrepresentation of God. It's like speaking a curse against God or somehow misrepresenting God. That's blasphemy." He says, "Only God can forgive sins." So they just answered their own question. Who does he think he is? Only God can forgive sins. Yes, that's right. That's right. One of the things that we forget, and just a brief talk on sin, is our offenses are against God. So when we sin, we are offending God. So who gets to forgive the offense? The one who is offended. God has the power to forgive sins because the sin is against him. I want you to jump to Psalm 51. I want you to see David. And if you don't know the story of David and Psalm 51, do you know the story of David and Bathsheba? David and Bathsheba was a married woman that David had an affair with. And to cover up the affair, she ends up becoming pregnant. And to cover up the whole scandal, her husband Uriah, David actually sees to it that he's killed in battle. Big scandal. Okay, about as bad as it gets. This is King David, the man who is described as a man after God's own heart, commits one of the greatest scandals in Scripture. But what we have is the reason why he was a man after God's heart was because he repented. And listen to his repentance. Psalm 51 is his repentance psalm. And this is the heart of David. This is the heart of repentance. David says, "Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion." It's not saying because you're so powerful. He's banking on God's love for his forgiveness. And he's putting his faith in his mercy and his compassion. "Because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins." This goes back to cleanliness. "Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night." When's the last time that you have been haunted by your sin? Or you've had regret about sin? But listen to what he says. "I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just." So he's putting himself at the mercy of God, and he's asking for his forgiveness. And you know what? That's when God forgives. When we're sorry for what we've done, and we have a conviction, then we are forgiven, but we have to accept the forgiveness. Sometimes people walk around in guilt and they walk around literally paralyzed because they're caught in this guilt. And what you see is this paralyzed man comes before Jesus. He says, "Your sins are forgiven." The Pharisees push back against him again. As we said, only God can forgive sins. Verse 22, Jesus knew what they were thinking. So we see his omniscience, the omniscience of God. God knows your thoughts. He knew their thoughts. Jesus was in a place. So the reason why Jesus fought against the Pharisees was not because they were religious. He fought against them because he knew their thoughts and he knew their hearts. And their hearts were far from God. Somehow, some way, they'd become these legalistic religious people that cared more about their rules and their rituals than they did about God. And that's not cool. That's not cool. It's not cool with Jesus. So Jesus, he knew what they were thinking, and he asked them, why do you question this where? In your hearts. Why do you question this in your hearts? So they had a heart problem with God. They had a heart problem, and Jesus knew it. Why is it so important? Why do we emphasize sincerity and genuine worship here at The Way? Because you know what? If your hearts aren't good, it really doesn't matter because you're not fooling God. So what we want to do is we want to help you get your hearts right before God. We all need that, right? We all need that calibration in our lives. And when somebody goes prolonged with just a bad heart before God, you just see the spiritual life just die in them. And maybe that's when they cling to religion and ritual more than anything. Because maybe they started out at a certain place, but somewhere along the line, their hearts grew hard. Jesus knows their hearts. Verse 23, is it easier to say your sins are forgiven or to stand up and walk? What you're about to see is you're about to see Jesus says it and he does it. The forgiveness of sins is an invisible transaction. You can't see it. It's just done. God declares it so. He declares we are justified. Our sins are atoned for, but we can't necessarily see that. But then what he does is he does something visible to validate the invisible. So Jesus doesn't just say, yeah, your sins are forgiven. Take them away. He says, your sins are forgiven. What is more difficult, to miraculously heal a paralyzed man or to forgive sins? And he does both. And so what you see him, he goes on to say, I will prove to you that the Son of Man is a term that Jesus uses and the gospel writers use to himself, which is used, depending on the translation, over 80 times in the New Testament. Jesus is referred to as the Son of Man. He says, I will prove to you that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. Where does the Son of Man come from? Where is this title? Why does Jesus use the Son of Man? A lot of skeptics say, well, Jesus never says that he's God. Nowhere in scriptures. And you know what? He says it all the time that he's God. That's actually one of the craziest arguments that I've ever heard. He never ever says at one point, I am God. You're right. But he says it in ways that there is no doubt that he is God. One of ways is by referring to himself as the Son of Man. Essentially what he's saying two things. One is that I'm God as man. But he's also referring to a specific text in the book of Daniel. Daniel, if we jump to Daniel 7, you're going to see a vision that Daniel had that was given to him. And in there, he sees these four great beasts, which represent kingdoms of the world. And he also sees something else, which, you know, he doesn't really understand at first till it's explained to him. But in Daniel 7, verse 13, he says, as my vision continued that night, I saw someone like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. That right there is language. Coming in the clouds of heaven is God. Something like a son of man. So what he's describing is he's describing a person that is fully man and fully God. in that statement alone. He says, coming in the clouds of heaven, he approached the Ancient One and was led into his presence. He was given authority, honor, and sovereignty over all the nations of the world so that people of every race and nation and language would obey him. His rule is eternal. It's an eternal kingdom. It will never end. His kingdom will never be destroyed. So it's this prophecy of this coming one. Then it goes on to say in verse 15, I, Daniel, was troubled by all I had seen, and my visions terrified me. So I approached one of those standing beside the throne and asked him what it all meant. He explained to me like this. These four huge beasts represent four kingdoms that will arise from the earth. But in the end, the holy people of the Most High will be given the kingdom, and they will rule forever and ever. So this, when Jesus says the Son of Man, this is the context in which he's referring. He is that person. And he's declaring, this is me. This is the prophecy that y'all have been looking for nearly 700 years. I'm him. It's an amazing assertion. But the holy people of the Most High will be given the kingdom, and they will rule forever and ever. So not only is a prophecy for Jesus, it's a prophecy for his followers. So not only is he given the eternal kingdom, but as his follower, so am I. It's an amazing prophecy. So this is the declaration that Jesus is making as he comes. And so he goes on, he says that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. Now, in this particular case, most theologians agree that probably his paralysis is directly connected to his sin. Maybe he was doing something, and somehow, some way, in the act of doing or committing a sin, he was paralyzed. I don't know. Take a modern-day equivalent. Let's say somebody goes out to a bar and gets drunk, and then they drive home and get into an accident, and then they're paralyzed in the accident. Okay, so they would actually literally sit there and say that my condition is the result of my sin. We oftentimes see that there's a physical response to our sin. Oftentimes, people get sometimes we do things here on earth that have physical consequences. Case in point is, you know, certain kinds of addictions. They bring us beyond. They alter our state. They do things like that. So many scholars believe that this is the correlation, that this man, Jesus, forgave his sins and he healed his paralysis, because his paralysis is directly a result of his specific sin. I'll tell you where we go awry in this today is that we tell people that all physical abnormalities are the result of sin. And the reason why you continue to be in that state is because you don't have faith. That's wrong. There are times when Jesus said, your sins are forgiven, now get up and walk. These things do happen, but it's not a mandate on all healing. Jesus turned to the man, said, stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. And immediately, as everyone watched, the man jumped up, picked up his mat, and went home praising God. Everyone was gripped with great wonder and awe, and they praised God, exclaiming, we have seen amazing things today. I want to stop right there. A couple weeks ago, I made this reference to the fact that we don't try to generate reverence through traditions or rituals. And the reason why we don't do that is because it's kind of a false reverence. And I'm not knocking people that do feel reverence for God in certain kind of Christian rituals. It's not what I'm saying. What I am saying, though, is that when you experience Jesus Christ and you experience the power of God and you are brought before Jesus, awe and reverence is going to happen no matter the situation. Here we have a situation where they are in a house surrounded by a crowd. You saw it. There wasn't a whole lot of ritual going on. There wasn't a whole lot of these things going on. But what you saw was you saw awe and reverence because they saw Jesus do what Jesus does, setting the captives free, releasing the oppressed, giving the blind sight, declaring the year of grace is here. We have seen amazing things today. They were gripped with great wonder and awe. So one of the things that we like to do here at The Way, and this is just our way of doing things. It's not the way of doing things. But we just feel like, and if I were to kind of describe a text that accurately represents The Way, I would say this is it. We want to bring people before God, and we want to see them have faith and be forgiven by Jesus. Now, here's the thing. I don't necessarily know at what point, because it's an invisible transaction, I don't know what point a person is forgiven. I don't know. And neither does anybody else. So we have people that come here, and you know what? They are notorious sinners. They do things. And I've had people that have come to me after service and say, do you know this person was here at the church today? Do you know who they are? And I'm like, you know what? I don't care who they are. I don't care what they've done. All I care about is that they are being brought before Jesus. They have as much a right to have their sins forgiven as anybody else. They have as much right to the gospel and to the foot of the cross as anybody else. It's not for us to say, well, you get to come into the kingdom. You don't, because that's what Pharisees do. So my heart as a pastor, I don't care who walks through that door. I don't care if they've got an armed guard and they're in belly shackles. I don't care. I don't care. I want them to hear the gospel. I want them to hear that Jesus Christ is declaring that the captives can be set free and the year of favor has begun, and they can come back to God, be forgiven of their sins, be cleansed, and be a part of what Jesus Christ is doing. And their lives can be transformed. They can have that reverence and awe that comes to coming before Jesus that transforms lives. Now, if you're wondering where we do draw the line, I'll just let you know. We do draw a line, but it's in leadership. So just so you know, leaders, if you move into a place of influence and leadership, well, now there's a line of accountability that's pretty important. You should have grown to a place before you become a leader or a person of influence within the kingdom where you personally are accountable. See, that's important. But there's a difference. There's a difference between the two. But yet it is important that we do seek righteousness and that we do revere holiness, because that's who God is. So if you're kind of wondering, well, you know, who should I invite to The Way? The answer is invite anybody. They can come here. They can hear the gospel. They can hear everything, and they can take it or leave it. They can hear this and they can leave. We're going to assume that probably there's people here in this story that saw this, felt the awe and the reverence of God, and then, you know what, got up, went home, and just kept on living their life. And that does happen. But that every so often, somebody is transformed by the power of God. And that is what we are seeking as a church. We're seeking that. And if that is you, then you are free to exercise and get to know God in deeper ways. And someday, as you progress, and you progress according to the power of the Holy Spirit, someday maybe you'll be a leader. And then you'll be able to help others and lead others and all those things. And that is that's the process that happens. So I want to just, as we continue forward, and you're going to see this keep going, and you're going to see this continue to progress in the text. I want to just remind us, what is the important thing here? Jesus sees the hearts. Jesus sees. He knows your thoughts and he knows your hearts. We're going to go into a time of communion here, and I just want to say one of those things about communion. There's actually a and I'm going to just kind of talk about this briefly. I'm not going to talk about it a lot, but there's something called fencing the table in Christianity. And what does that mean? It means that this is a sacrament, okay? This is a sacrament, which means that it's sacred, okay? We only have two sacraments as Protestants. We have communion and we have baptism. Those are our two sacraments, and it's important that what's important in sacraments is not what you've done this week. What's important is your heart. So as we come before communion, and we talk about fencing the table is where religious leaders try to gauge whether or not you should take communion. And if they don't think you should, they fence the table. You can't come to the communion table. Well, you know what? I'm not going to do that. I don't do that. What I do is I invite people based on their hearts. If your heart is not good, then don't take communion. You don't have to do it. It is not a ritual that earns you grace. Okay? It doesn't somehow make you better in the eyes of God. All that matters is your heart. So the question is, as we do an invitation here for communion today, is where's your heart? Do you want more of Jesus? Do you hunger for his righteousness? And if you do, you're invited at this communion table. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word today. Lord, we thank you for this picture of this paralyzed man whose sins were forgiven. Lord, may we look at that and take that upon ourselves. As a people that were helpless before you, a people that were literally paralyzed in our sins. And you alone, because you're God, declared us forgiven. So Lord Jesus, my prayer here today as we come before your communion table is that people will hear those words. Your faith. Because of your faith, your sins are now forgiven. Lord, help us be a people of faith. Help us in our hearts. Let us be genuine in our approach to you as we come before communion. We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. There's an old story. It's a good one, so I'm going to tell it. There's an old story about a young man that his father said to him, he said, "Son, today while I'm gone, I'd really like you to go out and mow the lawn." And the young man just totally blew it off. Dad comes home and sees that the lawn's not done, and he says to his son, he said, "Son, why didn't you mow the lawn like I told you to do?" And the son's like, "I just blew it. I'm sorry, Dad. I totally forgot, and I'm sorry. Please forgive me." And the father said, "You're forgiven. Now go out and mow the lawn." This father comes back about an hour later. He sees his son sitting at the table just with his head down and his hand over his eyes, just shaking his head. And the father said, "Son, what are you doing?" The son said, "Well, I'm thinking about how I let you down, and I'm so sorry, and I just wish you'd forgive me." And the dad says, "Son, you're forgiven. Now go out and mow the lawn." A little later, the dad goes outside, and there's the son sitting by the lawnmower. He's just in tears. And the father goes, "Son, what are you doing?" The son goes, I feel so bad." The father said, "Son, why don't you believe me that you're forgiven? Why don't you just do what I've asked you to do? You've been forgiven. I love you. Now go out and just mow the lawn." And see, I think we as Christians are kind of in that place. Jesus says we're forgiven. You're forgiven if you are in Christ. You're forgiven. Now go out and follow him and be believers. One of the ways you can do that as we move into this Lent season, like the friends of the paralyzed man, seek whom you could bring before Jesus. As you go out there, there's probably people in your lives. There's probably people that you know. Just ask them. Say, "Hey, you know what? Would you like to come with me to church? Would you like to?" "Yeah, but I don't have the right clothes, or I don't have this." You know what? The way is a place where you can come as you are. So I want to encourage you as you leave here, let this text, "You're forgiven. You can go out there and be an ambassador to Christ. You can bring others to Jesus." So go do it. Leave here with this blessing as you leave here today. May you go out there knowing the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ the Son, and the fellowship and the power of the Holy Spirit now and always. God bless you. You're dismissed. Now go out there and mow the lawn.